Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body Question Time. I would invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. The time for this item of business has been extended, but there is an awful lot of interest, so the usual plea for brevity in questions and responses as far as possible. And I call question number one, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Board whether it will provide an update on the waiting time for external stakeholder parliamentary events sponsored by MSPs.
Jackson Carlow.
I can confirm, Presiding Officer, that the extension was not at the request of the members of the corporate body. But can I thank Rachel Hamilton for her question? I know this is an issue that is of interest to a number of MSPs. The member-sponsored events and exhibitions programme is very popular. With this in mind, the corporate body previously agreed that event organisers could book up to 12 months in advance, which means the events and exhibition team are currently taking bookings from event organisers sponsoring members for events up to March 2025.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank Jackson Carlow for that answer. And according to the website, which was changed very recently, it was December 2024, and now the next opportunity for a member-sponsored exhibition is early 2025. And given that we pride ourselves in being a people's parliament, what is being done to ensure that stakeholders and citizens have the opportunity to engage with parliamentarians? And is this an issue of bureaucracy, or do we need to offer more flexibility of spaces to be used for events?
Jackson Carlow.
Well, I mean, first of all, can I say that in order to manage resources across the parliamentary teams as well as the parliamentary campus on busy business nights, an agreement was given by the corporate body to limit the number of events accordingly. We currently deliver and support between 9 and 10 member-sponsored events and 2 member-sponsored exhibitions weekly. Now, the events and exhibitions team will lead on the delivery and programming of the member-sponsored events and the exhibition programme, and also design and deliver the corporate body's agreed major events and exhibitions programme that supports the goals of the Scottish Parliament's public engagement strategy. It is, however, open to members out with that to organise events that are consistent with the meeting room booking policy, should they wish to do so. But, of course, they then would have to provide the infrastructural support to allow that meeting to take place, which I suppose reasonably is not practical for a large gathering, but would be practical for a smaller gathering. In terms of the wider point, the corporate body will look to see whether, as part of, I think, the legacy report of this Parliament to the next, if we reflect and find that there's been a significant increase in the whole demand for member-sponsored events, whether it would at that point be appropriate to suggest that that particular part of the corporate body infrastructure received additional resource.
You may not have asked for the extension in time, Mr Carlow, but with answers that long, we're going to need a further extension. I call question number two, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Parliament corporate body what plans it has to commission a portrait of King Charles as head of state.
Christine Graham.
I thank the member for his question. The SPCB is happy to consider suggestions from new commissions. We have asked parliamentary officials to explore options with a view to providing advice and recommendation to the SPCB in due course. We will keep you fully informed of these decisions, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank Christine Graham for that answer, and I'm sure she is as enthusiastic as I am about the prospect of having a portrait of our head of state displayed in the building, as would be appropriate, of course, in our national parliament. We, of course, already have a photographic portrait of the late Her Majesty the Queen opposite the public entrance. It is much admired by visitors, and I'm sure we would not want that to be removed, but complemented by a portrait of our new head of state. So can the member tell me whether there are any plans to relocate the existing portrait of Her Majesty the late Queen and ensure it continues to be displayed within the building?
Christine Graham.
I thank the member for his questions, which I'm delighted to answer. The position about whether we keep the portrait of the late Queen, that will be considered by the SPCB in due course when considering the new commission for King Charles. Thank you.
Question number three, Carol Mochen.
To ask the Scottish Parliament corporate body what steps it is taking to address any ethnicity-related pay gap amongst Scottish parliamentary corporate body staff.
Jackson Carlow.
And it is a complicated response, presiding officer, but the corporate body is proud of the steps it's taken to develop our minority ethnic staff, including an award-winning Emerging Leaders Development Programme, which was jointly developed by the Scottish Parliamentary Service, Edinburgh College and the Scottish Association of Minority Ethnic Educators. And this programme supported 13 staff to develop their leadership skills and prepare them for career development and advancement. The corporate body has also implemented a positive action approach to recruitment, which has significantly increased the numbers of applications received from people who identify as being minority ethnic and the successful appointment of such applicants. While progress has been made, we recognise that more needs to be done to reduce our ethnicity pay gap further, which is why we have made a commitment to develop a race strategy to tackle barriers in the workplace.
Carol Mochen.
Thank you. I thank the member for that answer. Recent reports on diversity monitoring and pay gaps for 21-22 show that ethnicity pay gap for all staff has increased from 27.6% in 21 to 30.1% in 22. And further to that, just 18% of applications for jobs in Scottish Parliament were from minority ethnic candidates in 22, compared to 78% from white candidates. With gaps existing in the success rates from those applications. So can the corporate body be clearer in what actual steps it's taking in the coming financial year to ensure that not only are staff from ethnic minority backgrounds paid fairly, but these vacancies are adequately promoted to ensure accessibility for these candidates?
Jackson Collum.
The Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body began reporting on its ethnicity pay gap in 2018-2019. And the median ethnicity pay gap for 22-23 stood at 20.1%, which I think is maybe a more up-to-date figure than the one Carol Mochen had, which was obviously down from the 30.1% in the previous year. In large part, this reduction has been achieved through concerted positive action in our recruitment approach, which has successfully increased our proportion of applicants and successful appointments for people who identify as minority ethnic. We've also reviewed our pay arrangements to ensure that they are transparent, equitable, consistent, flexible, and fair.
Thank you. Kate Forbes, question four.
To ask the SPCB whether it will provide an update on its plans to increase access to childcare in the creche beyond 3 hours per day.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. After considerable engagement with the Care Inspectorate and our service provider, Ohana, we successfully achieved a variation to our registration in December last year, increasing the hours from 4 hours a week to 3 hours a day, more than doubling the hours of childcare that can be provided. Alternatively, 4 hours can be taken in a single session if that is the only visit in a week. Since then, we've looked at further improving access of the creche to outdoor space, so children would have a free-flowing access to an outdoor space, and that might give us more flexibility with the Care Commission. However, to be clear, the Parliament design was always for a creche, and a nursery has very different requirements which our facilities cannot meet. We want to deliver the best facilities for children that we can and meet the most up-to-date guidance and criteria.
Kate Forbes.
Can I put on record my immense thanks to the SPCB, the Care Inspectorate and the Parliamentary Authorities for pursuing this, especially getting the change that Claire Baker has outlined in such a timely manner. I know that a huge amount of work went into it and I'm enormously grateful. Since the last time I asked this question, I think there have been two, although others might be able to correct me, reports of MSPs having children this summer. They will also need childcare when it comes to returning to work. And I'm sure that the SPCB would agree with me that MSPs work more than 3 hours per day. And so it's quite likely that there will continue to be demand for a facility that delivers what parents need in the Parliament rather than based on guidance that doesn't really meet the need.
Claire Baker.
I do appreciate Kate Forbes' welcome for the work that has been done by Corporate Body and the Care Inspectorate that has improved the offer that we have. We do recognise that members have a particular challenge with childcare. They need care both in Edinburgh and in their constituencies. And the creche is a service that can offer some support. But as I said, the design of the Parliament was to include a creche for occasional use. It is unfortunately not possible to convert this facility into a nursery and also meet the requirements of the Care Inspectorate. The Parliament is trying to be more family friendly. I think our ongoing investment in remote working for MSPs can provide some flexibility in managing care and responsibilities. And we are continuing to speak to the Scottish Government about the nursery at Victoria Quay. We do recognise that late business can have an impact and unpredictable hours can be difficult for parents and caring responsibilities. And we have made representation to the Bureau regarding this.
Question 5, Tess White.
ECB, how many visitors to the Scottish Parliament have been asked by security and other SPCB staff to remove badges and other apparel since May 2021?
Claire Baker.
Thank you. We do not hold data on the number of visitors whose items were retained, just the item details. So since reopening to the public in March 2022, security staff have retained 26 items at the main public entrance which meet the criteria in the member's question, including 5 badges, and the reasons for retaining the items are not currently held.
Tess White.
From badges to suffrage colours, it seems parliamentary staff are with growing frequency subjectively enforcing the visitor code of conduct. It's become one rule for some, but not others. And in the seat of Scottish democracy, policies of so-called inclusion are leading to the exclusion of women. This is a worrying and dangerous precedent, and it's unacceptable, and it must not continue. Will the SPCB commit to review not just the visitor behaviour policy in the Scottish Parliament, but all guidance and policies in relation to banners, flags, political slogans to ensure clarity, fairness and public participation? Thank you.
Claire Baker.
I thank the member for the supplementary. The Scottish the corporate body have commissioned a review of the protest policy that will include looking at items and dress, and I do recognise the need for policy to be consistent and to provide clarity. Corporate body staff must conduct themselves in an impartial manner. As an update, corporate body staff have until recently been allowed to wear personalised lanyards. This was introduced in 2017 as part of diversity and inclusion strategy. However, a review of the code of conduct has just been completed and a decision has been taken that all staff must wear the Parliament-issued purple lanyard. Staff who are employed by a corporate body. This decision will help to minimise the risk of perceived bias and avoid any perception that wearing such items may be influencing our own decision-making.
Thank you. Question 6, Graeme Simpson.
To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body whether it will give further consideration to allowing events to start in the Parliament building while members' business debates are ongoing.
Christine Graeme.
I thank the member for his question. As my written answer to the member's question in November on this said, to enable all members to take part in events and recognising that parliamentary business needs to take precedence, events do not take place at the same time as parliamentary business in the chamber. However, when business runs late, parliamentary officials will, where appropriate, work with the event organisers to ensure refreshments are served to event guests and they can go to the room where the event is taking place and meet with members, where possible. Speeches should only take place once parliamentary business is concluded, so all members have the opportunity to hear them. This pragmatic approach appears to be working, but as I said to the member in November, we continually keep this under review.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, thank you. I got a written response because I wasn't able to ask my question verbally at that time. Now, I'm asking for a review of the policy. I didn't want to know what the policy is. I know that. But people look forward to visiting this Parliament. They can go to a lot of time and expense to be here. And I think we should do better by them. Some events have to be cancelled. The worst example was one sponsored by Michael Mara, I think, on colleges, when people are actually on their way to the Parliament and it got cancelled. People are kept waiting in the lobby and events have to be curtailed. I would just plead to the corporate body that they have a review of this policy, which seems devoid of any common sense to me.
Christine Grimm.
Well, as the member will appreciate, late sittings are not a matter for the Bureau. That's not a matter for the corporate body, but are a matter for the Bureau, for which we have no control. But can I put some context into this? Between January and June 23, there were 6 events cancelled due to Parliament sitting late. However, from September 2023 until this week, only one event, and that was this week, had to be cancelled. That's a total of 7 out of 324 events. Of the 7 that were cancelled since January 2023, 3 have been rescheduled. We always try to give priority to events we've had to reschedule. But I hear what the member is saying, and if there can be improvements, I'm sure the corporate body will consider it.
Thank you. Question 7, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body whether it will look into rolling out accessibility options such as BSL and EasyRead as standard across all forms of public participation.
Maggie Chapman.
Can I thank Karen Adam for that question? When planning what participation support is needed for parliamentary activities, including committees, staff generally recommend a targeted approach based on the audiences identified as priority groups for each piece of work and taking into account the barriers to their participation. Accessibility options relevant to the audience are developed with partners. For example, the Healthcare in Remote and Rural Areas Inquiry was developed in EasyRead as we knew adults with learning disabilities would face additional barriers. Work planned for the Disability Commissioner Scotland Bill will include BSL and EasyRead versions of the call for views. And lastly, Karen Adam will be interested to know that a public consultation for our new BSL plan, due to run from 2024 to 2030, is scheduled to take place this summer. And it will involve the use of citizen space and will be made fully BSL accessible.
Karen Adam.
I am delighted and thankful for the member for that answer. I'm particularly proud that for the first time in the history of the Scottish Parliament, the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, which I convene, will be the first committee to trial the use of WhatsApp to allow the BSL users to respond to our call for views on Jeremy Balfour's Disability Commissioner Bill. We've also ensured that EasyRead and other accessible versions of our call for views are ready at the time of launch to ensure parity. Will the SPCB join me in encouraging other committees and the Scottish Parliament more widely to promote equality and inclusion by adopting these practices?
Maggie Chapman.
Can I thank Karen Adam for that supplementary? I think the WhatsApp trial will give us really good experience on how to receive evidence by video, and we are hoping that this will be of use not only to our BSL communities but to others too. Of course, it's not for corporate body to dictate committees how to do their business, but if the pilot works, then other committees may wish to use this method, and it is perhaps something that the conveners group can discuss further. And of course, we want to make sure that we are promoting different practices, alternative ways of getting and widening participation.
Brief supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thank you. Given that this is British Sign Language Week, I find that response slightly disappointing, as I'm sure many BSL users will. It's not for us or the body to decide editorially what BSL users may or may not be interested in from a committee point of view. Surely in this modern day and age, we could make better use of technologies to ensure wider participation in parliamentary activity.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank Jamie Green for that supplementary. I think we recognise that people with accessibility requirements are interested in many issues, as you outline, not just specific those linked to their access needs. I think by focusing on barrier removal, we think we have the balance of interest levels right in terms of access, cost to the public purse, and so on. The Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee's recent report welcomed our work to develop systematic and cost-effective approaches to the use of different languages and formats to increase accessibility in our consultation and participation work. But of course, we are always eager to do more and would welcome further conversations and ideas and suggestions the member may have.
Thank you. Question 8, Richard Lennon.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the corporate body what consideration it is giving to the establishment of a permanent memorial to Michael Mick McGaughey in this Parliament.
Christine Graham.
I thank the member for his question. We are due to consider the request the member has made to the SPCB at our next meeting on Thursday, 18th April, and we'll update the member as soon as we can. The SPCB notes the support expressed during the recent members' debate, and we'll take that into consideration.
Richard Lennon.
Can I thank Christine Graham for that answer? The National Union of Mine Workers, the McGaughey family, Green MSPs, Labour MSPs, Liberal MSPs, SNP government ministers, journalists past and present, and just this week the STUC all support a memorial. So will the corporate body meet with the NUM, the family and me to work out how a fitting legacy to this working class hero can be delivered in time for the centenary of his birth next year.
Christine Graham.
Well, it's a very kind invitation, but it's not the practice of the corporate body to meet with anyone. Individuals. With regard to the point being made, because we're holding our meeting, these decisions are not taken on a blank canvas. The SPCB has a number of related policies, including the memorial policy and the Scottish Parliament's art collection development policy, which we will all take into account when we come to a decision whether or not there's a memorial to Mick McGahey.
And brief supplementary, John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, on the topic of permanent memorials, one of my constituents who actually approached me as one of my first constituency cases 27 years ago was affected by the contaminated blood scandal, and he is keen to establish some form of memorial in this Parliament to recognise those who have lost their lives in this scandal. As the United Kingdom inquiry is expected to report shortly, would the corporate body give consideration to the question of whether or not the Parliament may be a suitable venue for a memorial to those who have lost their lives in the contaminated blood scandal?
Christine Graham.
Yes, I thank the member for his supplementary. Really, I will duplicate the answer I gave to Mr. Leonard, that if he makes an application to the corporate body, we will consider it against the backcloth of the memorial policy, the Parliament's art collection and other representations.
Question 9, Ivan McKee.
To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what systems are in place to ensure that changes to IT systems and processes in the Parliament that will impact on the daily working practices of MSPs and their staff are consulted upon, tested, introduced, explained and evaluated.
Maggie Chan.
I thank Ivan McKee for that question. Where projects are changing the way that members and their staff work, officials will build in opportunities for consultation and feedback, and often roll out the change to a smaller pilot group to gather feedback, tweak implementation and prepare appropriate training and communications. There are times, of course, where it is necessary to introduce certain changes at short notice, for example, to protect against emerging cyber security threats. The corporate body is keen to hear from members if and when they feel that we can collectively do better to keep them and their staff informed of any changes or developments.
Ivan McKee.
My question is prompted by introduction of system changes, for example, the recent quarantine system that's added another layer of complexity, made it more difficult to find and in some cases lose track of important communication from constituents and added to MSP staff's workload, or prior to that, the introduction of the new reimbursement system that in its early stages was very cumbersome and difficult to operate. And I think the point I'm making to the body is and asking to what extent do they feel empowered to push back on the IT department that may come with new whiz-bang systems to introduce but haven't been thought through and checked with MSP staff as to their implication on workload and whether in fact they're often necessary at all.
Maggie Chapman.
Mr. McKee highlights the interesting issue which may have come as a bit of a surprise to some in the Chamber. In the main, corporate body accesses software and cloud services on a subscription basis, including the Microsoft 365 applications for our email system and other office functions. Microsoft makes modifications and updates that are then available immediately to users, enhancing functions or addressing cyber vulnerabilities. Quarantine is one such update, introduced to protect users from emails that are potentially harmful, like phishing or malware. BIT recently introduced the new alerting system to let members know when email messages had been placed in quarantine, and I think that's the change that Mr. McKee is referencing. The notification system was introduced by BIT because it would otherwise not be automatically obvious to users that messages had been quarantined, and that was in response to something that Microsoft had done behind the scenes. As far as the allowances system being updated, members and staff were offered a range of training options during the rollout of the system, with step-by-step instructional material available on the internet. Allowances officers and other parts of the parliamentary estate continue to provide support and advice to members, and of course we always welcome feedback and challenge and pushback where members or their staff think that something will not work. Those views will be taken into consideration.
Thank you. Question 10, Jackie Dunbar.
To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body whether it will consider stocking alcohol-free variants of spirits, wine and other alcoholic beverages in the Scottish Parliament gift shop.
Christine Graham.
I thank the member for her question. I agree with the member that this would be good for the shop to stock alcohol-free options. A retail manager regularly checks the market for such products, most recently at the start of this year. Unfortunately, we have so far been unable to find a product which could be branded and meet our requirements for low minimum quantity ordering. We'll keep checking, though, and update the member if we are successful.
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank Christine Graham for her answer. Many people now do not drink alcohol for all sorts of reasons, including health and religion. Not that anyone ever needs a reason. A recent survey suggested that 44% of 18 to 24-year-olds now regularly or occasionally drink alcohol alternatives. Alcohol alternatives now mean that you do not need to drink alcohol to be able to enjoy the taste of some of our nation's most famous drinks. So can I ask what more can be done to encourage producers and suppliers to the Parliament to offer alcohol-free alternatives, allowing our Parliament to move with the times and to stock a more inclusive range of gifts?
Christine Graham.
I advise the member the difficulty is that branded items designed for us and available nowhere else remain popular to customers, from the tartan scarves to malt whisky. We know our alcohol products are popular because of Parliament's branding and uniqueness to us. Our whisky range is currently supplied under contract by the own label company who are based in Edinburgh. They do not, unfortunately, yet have alcohol-free drinks in their product portfolio, but we continue to investigate this.
Question 11, Jamie Green.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what steps it is considering to ensure the safety of the public, MSPs and staff entering or exiting the Scottish Parliament campus in light of a number of recent events of concern.
Claire Baker.
The Corporate Body takes its security and safety responsibilities very seriously. There are a wide range of physical and personal security arrangements in place to ensure the safety of everyone visiting or working in the building. The security arrangements reflect heightened response. This is the required stance for the UK threat level, which is presently set at substantial. While there have been recent incidents, the threat and subsequent response level have not changed since February 2022.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the member for that? But despite all of that, in recent weeks, we have seen a spate of attempts to disrupt this democracy in this Parliament. We've had interference from the gallery during FMQs, members of the public being harassed or even prevented from entering the building during protests. Members and even our staff accosted by those protesters upon exiting various points of the building. And of course, the building outside was daubed in red paint just last week. Some might say that was an improvement. But seriously, in the current febrile environment that politics is, this is more than unacceptable. It could be potentially dangerous. So can I ask, has there been any investigation into these specific protests? And if any of them were facilitated or aided by any MSP or MSP group? And secondly, why is exterior security in the Parliament clearly failing to keep all of us, the building, our staff and the public safe?
Claire Baker.
The members raised a number of points. In terms of protests that have been outside the building, we do welcome peaceful protests outside the building, but I do recognise there have been some recent incidents that have been a cause for concern. But the management of protests and the safety of the public are a matter for Police Scotland. And while we do work very closely with Police Scotland, they are responsible for public safety. I can, however, confirm that a review of the protest that took place last month, its impact and lessons learned, was immediately commissioned by the security team and is currently underway. And I can also confirm that we are looking into allegations that pass holders helped protesters block entrances by sharing information.
Thank you. Question 12, Stephen Kerr.
Question 12. I was going to come in as a supplementary to be helpful, but to ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what steps it will take to ensure that any protests and demonstrations to disrupt the ability of MSPs, staff and the public to access the Scottish Parliament are fully investigated with any findings and lessons learned available to MSPs.
Claire Baker.
As I said, we do welcome peaceful protests outside the building. We do recognise there have been recent incidents, and a review of the protest and its impact and lessons learned is currently underway. As I said, the safety of the public outside the building is an issue for Police Scotland. We are assured that the Security Office is progressing on the review. If there are any recommendations that require corporate body approval, we will consider the findings in due course, and any approved recommendations will be notified to members.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, I heard the answer just given and the previous answers, and it's clearly unacceptable that any group or individual attempt to disrupt the workings of this Parliament or bar people from either entering or leaving the building. But we've had a number of instances, as has just been described by Jamie Green. So it's clearly intolerable that any of these activities were aided and abetted by members of this Parliament. Yeah. And that has happened. And we all know that has happened. It's been boasted about on social media. So when these reports that were described become available and their findings, can any breach of the MSP Code of Conduct be published and made available to members? And will the corporate body, as now established in precedent, make the, any reports they have in relation to MSP complicity in these activities subject to a referral to the Standards Committee of this Parliament?
Claire Baker.
I assume that the member is aware of the mechanism for reporting any concerns over MSP's behaviour, and this would not be a matter for the corporate body. And as I said, it is not a matter for the corporate body. And as I said earlier, we are looking into allegations that pass holders helped the protesters block entrances by sharing information. But at this point in time, that is allegations.
Thank you, Ms. Baker. That now concludes Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body questions. There will be a brief pause till we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.